The most important information I got was pretty much at the end, where she really broke down the demographics and the audience for the school life. Because I'm an advertiser, I've always done more for our typical demographic, which is women, 25 to 54. But at how she spoke about the youth being the true audience, I'm actually going to make some changes with my messaging. And so that was the most important part.
Understanding the funnel, I think, especially as a retail business, as a food business, my funnel is kind of short, but I think it's important to understand, the awareness piece, because so much of mine, and I think what we've done is a lot of call to action kind of things, whereas, maybe we need to, think awareness. I mean, it certainly broadened my thought process, I think. And then, again, just understanding, because I'm approached by businesses or advertising advertisers all the time, and it's understanding what that demographic is going to be and whether that's going to be my target demographic.
So in Marketing Bootcamp 201, it became boot camp because we're talking about, as I mentioned, six sections that are all relative to content marketing. And content is critical mass because, as we know, content is king. And in marketing, there's lots of buzzwords that people share about how important content is. In social media, the buzzword became you have to be authentic, like this is news. And then someone says that it's really important that we storytell, like this is news. It isn't. It's what we do every single day when we interact with human beings. And what gets lost in marketing messaging in haste and very often just in desire to give information is we forget that we're trying to relate to humans. And it happens because we even say words that are naughty. We want to hit people with this message. Why would you want to hit anyone? You're not hitting people. You want to reach them. You want to invite them to come and engage with you. You want them to purchase. You want them to be a part of what it is that you're doing in your business to grow it. So even just incidental verbiage that we use, and that's how people sometimes think of a marketing message. And that's where we kind of sometimes even huge multi-million-dollar corporations make the same mistake, is it's our desire and urgent need to meet sales goals and deadlines to hurry up and shove information out there. And then the great, I've got to get my name out there. And do what with it? What is it doing while it's out there? Is it reminding people how much they were really irritated with you in their last transaction? Or is it encouraging them to engage with you again? So it isn't just about pushing out. It's making sure that you're sharing, that you're reaching, that you're engaging, that you're relating. So that's intro. We've already spent, 5 minutes talking about intro, and I promise to be done at 8:40. We may run to 8:45, which could abbreviate some of the questions. I promise you'll be released here by 9 a.m. You've got businesses to run, and I realize that there's a lot going on in everybody's every day. So I'll be quick, even if we have to move through some of this material a little bit faster. But I want you to understand that the premise of this conversation is all about content. And the whole reason for that is to make sure that we remember to engage with human beings and get them to do what it is we want them to do in coming into our business and engaging with us. Whatever product or service you sell, the basic criteria is the same. It doesn't matter if you're spending $1.5 million in marketing or if you're spending $10,000 in marketing. The premises, the basic principles are the same. Huge companies spending multi-millions of dollars make the same mistakes that a mom and pop store do when they place marketing messages. I see it every single day. I've been a part of organizations that have done it. You have got to be kidding me. This is your best concept. Because genius cannot happen until the 101 is right. And if you miss those 101 things, it doesn't matter how much money you spend, you can't fix it. You need to do 101 right. So I'm a big fan of that. No matter how great a golfer you are, you have to practice your swing. It's the exact same thing in marketing. There isn't genius attached. It's just obvious, and sometimes the obvious escapes us, because I find the tool that's missing most often in marketing, not by purpose, but it's usually common sense. And I think that happens in our everyday lives everywhere we look. So our units today, we're going to talk a little bit about customer patterns. We're going to talk about message consistency. Don't worry about writing all that down. It's all here for you. Storytelling, targeting messages, and choosing media platforms to apply those messages. Come on in, sit down. Welcome. And then we want to talk about applying the right message on that media platform. So there are going to be a variety of things that all interrelate. They're dynamic together. And we're going to make some assumptions along the way. If you want to ask me questions afterward, I'm happy to stay and discuss that until we, you know, can have cocktails this evening. No, I'm just kidding. But I will be here for a little while afterward as well. And certainly if there's something I've said that sounded confusing in the midst of this presentation, please raise your hand and I'll be happy to answer at any point in time. So I'm talking about customer patterns. One of the things that's important is that we understand that our customers have patterns. They have habits just like we do. And I'm assuming, we'll stop for a brief moment and go back one step. I'm assuming that each of you already understand who your primary customer is in your place of business, where you're a decision maker, influencer, or business owner. And by that, I'm not talking about, you know, someone says, I'll ask you, who do you do business with? They always answer, well, everyone. Okay, so 70% of your revenue comes from 85-year-old women. Well, no. Okay, well, 75% of your revenue comes from two-year-olds. Well, no. Okay, they're between 2 and 85. Can we get closer now? So the point is, where are your primary dollars coming from? 70% of your revenue, who is your primary customer? You know that. So we're going to assume that that's a given. We don't have to go through that step today because we're at the 201 level. So customer patterns. We want to make sure that you study and understand your customer patterns. And it's where you'll find your advertising messages and how to communicate with them. The most important thing to remember, the overarching theme, no matter what you do in watching and learning and listening for customer patterns, is the word listen. So we want to talk about identifying patterns and change. First, you need to know what their patterns are. And we find those things out every single day, obviously face-to-face. If you're dealing with your customers face-to-face, if you're not, and there are frontline employees of yours that do, and you're further up the food chain, that you are the problem solver, not the immediate face-to-face, you want to be sure that you're interfacing on a very regular basis with your frontline staff so that you do understand what it is that's happening with customers, what are they asking today, what's going on. So through visual observation, I'm referring to face-to-face or something that you notice that they're not doing, they used to do, that you can even see in their dynamic interaction with you when they're doing business with you. Obviously, there's inventory shifts. Sometimes you find out for some reason you're not ordering as much of this and you're ordering more of that, whatever it may be. That's indicating a pattern change, right? You can do lots of tools that we have at our disposal today, the infamous Google Analytics, which tell us so many varied things that we never really needed to know. But a lot of things that are very, very helpful that might suddenly indicate to you a little telltale sign of something you didn't see. So monitoring Google Analytics for those people who are online and they have information at their disposal, use it understanding that people that are interacting with you online may not represent the customer base that comes through your door. So be mindful of that these people are a representation of a piece of the business that you're in unless you're entirely online driven. Very different matter. But remember and keep those things in mind because that customer base that might be coming to you in an online format could be younger, could be more male, could be very tech savvy, could be a higher financial bracket than the person who comes through the door to see you. So do not assume that Google Analytics alone is a sufficient way to gauge what it is your customers are doing. I put FB Insights, and obviously we're doing double secret code for Facebook. One of the things that's important to monitor as well, if you're using social media platforms, and I'm assuming most of us are not using large vendors that are monitoring all of the touches and output and all of our messaging out there, and they come at a price point of about $100,000 a year to do that for you, so probably you're not doing that. And when you look at things like Facebook Insights, and if you have a Facebook presence and you look at those insights, you might find some interesting things happening. Facebook in general is relatively young in the dynamic of online. It tends to be a little bit more male, and it tends to run 25, 34 years of old age, but your customer base on Facebook might not look at all like that. I have a client whose 90% of their audience on Facebook is women 35, 54. That's very contrary to Facebook, but we know that moms and women are far more aggressive on moving onto Facebook than they were when it first initiated. And no matter what people say about Facebook is, you know, passe, it's gone by the wayside. It is the largest social media platform in the world, and it is not going anywhere. What's happening is there's a certain age group that's defecting because mom's there, I'm out. So this means that we're looking at youth fleeing Facebook for other platforms. Primarily Twitter is still their lead, but then the next one after that is Instagram. So remember that even social media platforms have different age groups that you want to address and consider. One of the other things that people do is customer surveys, face-to-face. You ask people, have them fill out a form, whatever it may be. Of course, online survey, and there are many other ways that you can watch for customer patterns. The infamous online survey that probably most of us click out and get so irritated with, it's the site I keep going to, stop asking me if you can give me feedback about your site. And you want to be mindful if you're doing them. Be kind, ask people, give them the option to opt out, and don't serve them the same question again. I would suggest to you that you just keep them 3-4 questions deep if you do them, get a nugget out of them. 3 months later, pop it up and do it again. If they say no, you do not serve that message to them again. I am one of those people that believes in irritating customers is a really bad plan for keeping them. So why are we looking at patterns and changes in patterns? Because we want to find opportunity. And it's opportunity for how to speak with someone about something that's important to them. It's a pattern that they have. And a shift in that pattern might mean that there's a window for you to influence them in a different way than you have. It could mean that you can sell or package something that was there before, but you can package it or sell it anew because it might indicate that they're receptive to something differently than they were. So this requires you to think about what it is that's going on and frequently probing and asking them questions. What did you mean by that when you said that? And it's really important that you listen, and that's what we talk about when we say listening. Social media itself is a great tool for listening. You can do surveys, of course, in social media platforms. What are people saying when they're on social media and engaging with you? That platform is actually for listening instead of talking as your business, and that's very important to remember. And people use it, again, as a talk, shout, out platform or method of communication, and really it's a listen communication tool. So it's also an opportunity to reacquaint someone. You recognize that there's a pattern shift and, hey, I need to reacquaint them, I haven't seen them in a while. That's kind of the easiest one to rely on. To introduce yourself to someone, there's a pattern that's new, which means there's other people that are lookalikes that you could introduce yourself to based on people that you had done business with that have had a pattern shift. And you can continue and expand to communicate with them. So customer patterns, we have known patterns. You want to identify changes. You want to look for opportunity that those changes tell you about. And you want to adjust your messaging as appropriate so that you're aware of and staying in step with what your customers are doing. Again, the whole overarching theme about customer patterns is listen, listen, and listen. Note, and that's for me, there can be shifts in patterns based upon groups. It can be gender, it can be age, it can be experience, stage of life. It could be all kinds of things that certain groups have a pattern shift where these people don't ever change. And so it's important to be sensitive to that. You're absolutely going to see a difference in customer pattern shifts that will vary between adults and teens, for example. So it's important to pay attention to those groups in your marketing message because they won't be communicated with in the same fashion. So we've addressed a little bit about customer patterns. Again, we can revisit any of these as we go. But now we're going to move into looking at some message consistency aspects. And message consistency is something that I think is often overlooked. And the reason for that is that we're always trying to find new ways to invite people to come in and do business with us. We feel a sense of urgency to hurry up. I mean, we are a hurry-up society. How many of us stand in front of the ATM and go, hurry up, I've got to go. The 20 is not coming out fast enough, right? It's like, why is everything so very hurry-up? So much so that we really make some terrible mistakes. I just hit 200 and I meant 20. Okay, that's fine, but I may have overdrawn myself. So it's important to remember to just breathe a quick moment because message consistency could be more valuable to you than you know. There's an interesting article, and this is just a snippet out of it, a gentleman by the name of Avi Dan, who is a marketing writer for Forbes magazine. He made a comment that I felt was worth repeating for you. In a market of constant change and innovations and overall advertising clutter, it can be tempting to alter your advertising message in an attempt to be, I love this line, I've got to be different than everybody else, and I need to stand out, okay, so that people avoid you. Okay, we want to make sure that we know what it is you're standing out doing. So sometimes change can be necessary. It's very true. if you find that you're absolutely not getting any traction with your messaging. But is it something about your messaging? Is it the right messaging at the wrong time? Is it the right messaging at the right time to the wrong audience? Is it the right audience, right time, right messaging, wrong medium? So there are many things that you need to filter before you make a choice to say, abandon ship, get rid of this message, eject. There are various things that you might need to consider before you make that change. Because many times, Avidan describes, and he's correct, it can actually be detrimental to your brand. I love this concept because something about consistency in messaging can be a thread beyond your logo. It can be a slogan. And Nike launched Just Do It in 1987. That message has permeated everything they do for 28 years. Are you tired of it yet? I mean, maybe, but I will know when I see Just Do It, I better hurry up and sweat. I mean, there's pressure here. I've got to get on. I've got the wrong shoes on. I'm not wearing the right clothes. I know I need to just do it. I don't know what it is I've got to do, but I better do it, and I've got to do it with a swoosh because I got to be fast. They understand that there was not any point, once they found engagement with the Just Do It campaign, it can take so many iterations in the slogan. So here's a great example of a brand that didn't abandon that slogan out of pressure. And when they first launched this, Reebok was selling 3 times the number of shoes Nike was. Today, Nike outsells by about tenfold Reebok. And it's kind of important to recognize that they owned it, they took it, they ran with it, they commit to it, and they make it part of our lives. And that's one of the messages about understanding why consistency can be important. So here's another fun little story about messaging. And this is a Smokey the Bear commercial.
Okay, so we drowned the fire, stirred it, drowned it again, and now just feel if it's cold.
Yeah.
Cool.
Smokey just gave me a bear hug.
I know. I already posted it.
This is a commercial, only you can prevent wildfires, that they launched in 2014. So the commercial came from 2014, the Smokey the Bear. And Ad Council actually introduced Smokey the Bear in 1944. 60 years? I think that's 70. How old am I? It's 71 years, right? So they launched Smokey the Bear 71 years ago. It's actually the longest standing icon that was in advertising ever. And the reason for these things being important to you is that it builds the case for the reason why it's okay to be consistent, even if you're kind of bored with yourself a little. It's all right. So here's an image from a magazine in 1948. We see Smokey, and we kind of recognize that Smokey the Bear, though none of us were around in 1948. So I'm sure that I saw it in a magazine that my grandparents had. And remember, only you can prevent forest fires. And this was a magazine spot as well as a poster that the Ad Council used. And then here is Smokey the Bear in 2014. Only you can prevent wildfires. Somewhere along the line, they shifted from forest fires to wildfires. I would probably attribute that to California being at fault because we think of California and they're always wildly on fire, or they're flooding like mad, or they're shaking. But the point is that they made a subtle iteration. Smokey the Bear is there. Smokey is consistent. And the tagline with a tiny modification has been there for 71 years. So it's okay if you've been saying the same thing for a year and a half. It's okay. Don't be alarmed and think that you have to shift that necessarily. So consistency can be the slogan. It can be a theme or a character. It can be a jingle. Jingles are great. We're father and son. We do it all. You know, no job's too big, no job's too small. I could do that anywhere. You could ask me at any point in time. I could recite their jingle. I don't know why, but they're very smart. They launched that in the early 1980s. That's a jingle that works. Jingle alone. They can change all the graphics and the imaging they want. The jingle alone can carry them through and be sustainable for message consistency. It can be the look of an ad, that your ads always kind of look that way. But what you're saying in the content or the fabric of that can change. It's important to remember that we tire of our own messages far sooner than our customers do. So we've talked a little bit about customer patterns. They're out there. We need to know what they're doing. what's happening, how they shift and what they are changing toward, leaving, maybe giving us opportunity for marketing in our own businesses, and the importance of staying consistent in messaging, talking to our customers. And talking to them now takes a phase in this conversation today that I want you to remember, again, the concept that we're trying to engage with humans. So storytelling, since the beginning of time, stories are how we related to one another. They're fashioned in many ways, including words, pictures on a cave wall, and today videos. They didn't have videography like we do today. And these elements are commonly found in social media when you talk about videos being played and are permeating traditional media messaging. And most often, you hear the phrase that we need to be authentic in social media. And there's absolutely truth to that. But if you're being authentic in social media and you're being, you know, somehow coy, sly, not quite as authentic in traditional media, that's a really strange thing to do. So being authentic is applying in everything you do. It's like being transparent. It's like the concept of content is king. It's about whatever, garbage in, garbage out. We can call it all kinds of things, but the same thing is true. You need to be forthright. You need to be authentic. You need to be relatable in every single platform where your marketing messages appear, no matter what you do, no matter where you are. And social media wizards seem to think it was their ingenious idea to be authentic. I'm like, well, that's great. Thank you. But actually, we've been authentic for decades before you even developed. So there are four components to storytelling. And for those of you who may have even read ahead, in here, there's emotion that's important, that you tap into emotion. You need to determine how you're relevant to people, and then how you speak from your audience's point of view, and then what do you have in common. So from emotion, let's talk about, those are four components that comprise storytelling. So from emotion, it's interesting to find that even the geekiest data-driven scientists are still motivated to make purchases based on emotion. I just like that thing. It's cooler, it's faster, it's stronger, it's smaller, it's smarter, it's fill in the blank. That's emotion that's driving that purchase decision. So it isn't just emotion in terms of somebody being exuberant. It's an emotional pull, it's a drive. It's something that is beyond the transactional price of that particular decision to make a service or product engagement. So emotion still, no matter what, is a primary driver in any decision someone makes to transact business. I'm not talking about I just got a flat tire. That's an urgency. That could be an emergency depending on where you're standing. But I'm thinking about maybe I need some new tires. I really like those people down the street. That's an emotion. Now I'm going to price them and see how they are competitively. So there's emotion attached when it's a choice. When it's not a choice, obviously we've had some sort of an urgency. So those things, of course, stand alone. So a customer should immediately understand how they will benefit from a purchase from you. Not what are the features, how will those features benefit them to get it from you? That's the emotion. So why is it important? The it here is you. Why are you important? You want to lead with your why when you're talking and messaging. It's your purpose, it's your reason for being, because it's your unique to your business. In other words, yes, I need my name out there. Doing what? Making sure that people understand how you're the differentiator. What is it that clearly states why your business is significant and how it matters to customers? So it's important to remember, you need to remember why you're important. Why do they do business with you? And make sure you think that through in their language. Next step, audience point of view. Understanding the customer's mindset gives you the ability to understand what motivates them. Of course it does. If you don't speak from their point of view, you can actually cause them to feel disconnected or disenfranchised from you. So if you speak in terms that they have no connection to whatsoever, you could have the right price item at the right time talking to the right target audience and they still don't buy, because you made them feel disenfranchised from you, because you didn't relate to them, you were not relevant. And that's what's really important in remembering your audience's point of view, and your various audience groups have different points of view. How you relate to them and how you talk to them on different platforms is an important piece of this equation. So what do you and these folks have in common? So when you understand how your business is important, and we do, but make sure we really understand how it's important to them, and learn more about your customer's point of view, you'll find a natural relationship in how you can message. And this is true. I'm not kidding. This happens every single time I talk to customers, my clients, who are trying to speak to their consumers, and I ask them and ask them again and ask them again. No, you have to tell me why that's different. Why are they coming to you? I have the best price. That's not good enough. I can shop online and find it cheaper. That's not a good enough answer. You have to have some other not commodity-driven reason why you're unique. And they can get there. It may be painful, but you have to understand that and relay that in your messaging. So you use messaging to build on this connection with customers, relating to a shared experience with them. And that shared experience, that you find something in common. You provide something that they need. Now we have a common experience. And this message is from Dick's Sporting Goods.
She was a good companion, eyes like the Grand Canyon. Yeah! Was an American beauty. She was a long goodbye. She was the best alibi. She was an American beauty. With her wafers on in the summer sun, her touch felt like a loaded gun. Wish I had held her long. Wish I had held her long.
So we've told an entire storyline. Every family, every gift, every legacy, every season starts at Dick's. So Dick's understood very clearly, as do all of us, that there's a relationship between the product that I sell and how it is important in my life as the customer. It's not about a basketball. It's about the relationship that I have using that basketball with my daughter, and we're going to have a shared experience. That's what that 60-second commercial told you. I have to go to Dick's. They will be the only people who have a basketball that will endure all of these seasons and all of the years of my daughter's life, and they have the only hoop that I can take with me everywhere I go, and all I'll ever need to do is change the net. I'm going to Dick's. So this is what's important about understanding storytelling. So they touched, this was a seasonal ad, obviously it ran last December, but they're showing you your purchase from us cascades through your life, and we understand you, we get you. And so there's a connection that they relayed to people in this ad very successfully, that we will now be a part of your life in this very small investment in the hoop and the basketball for her at Christmas. What are you doing, Dad? Get in there and get it. They didn't do price point. They didn't talk about any of that. That's nonsense. I have to have that. I need that relationship, and that's about storytelling. It's an emotional move. So we talked about customer patterns. We talked about message consistency. We've gotten a little bit of insight into storytelling, and now we're going to discuss how do we target some of those messages, because as we all know, it's important that we do it with consistency. We've agreed on that. I agreed. None of you said yes. I did see a head or two nod, but I'll assume that we agreed. We retain a thread of continuity in messaging, and now we want to adapt it slightly. That thread can be anything. That goes with us, but we're going to adapt that messaging to reach appropriate audiences. And this applies to concepts like demographics and psychographics to audiences, as well as cycles related to your businesses and their window, where they are in the marketing bridge and the decision to make a purchase. So we talk about targeting messages. We want to think about things like gender, because men, boys, relate to messaging very differently than women, girls. We talk about age. If you're talking to somebody 17 or you're talking to somebody 70, they respond and interact a little bit differently. We refer to them about lifestyle. If it's family, if we're single, all kinds of things about I love to go camping. I do not. I love to golf. I can't stand any activity besides reading and going to movies. So we have lifestyle issues that we also want to be sure that we understand where we're relevant and where we are in our messaging, talking to people. Geographically, there's reasons why something geographically immediate to you could have a different message that you're carrying further out away from you. In a shared experience, we'd consider timing of that message. and is this the right time in the product cycle for me to share this message? And there are lots of other variables, but these are just some of the ones that you want to take in consideration before you just quickly hurry up and figure out what you want to say in that ad. So our friend, the Marketing Bridge, and please pardon me for those of us who've all been in marketing classes together at some point in time. I go back to the Marketing Bridge because it's important to remember that we love it when people are down at the make the purchase point of the funnel, but they don't start there. They start elsewhere. And this is the whole point about understanding the importance of a media mix, because every single medium does not impact people at each stage of this marketing bridge. And first in, first out, if you're the people impacting them at the awareness level, you're typically the person they come to at the make the purchase level. And so, for example, awareness. Huh. I have never seen a zero turn radius lawnmower before. I didn't even know I needed one. That thing is cool. That's awareness. I don't know where it came from, saw it somewhere, may have been in a commercial. Single largest medium that impacts awareness advertising is television. You will never, in awareness advertising, touch anyone with a Google AdWord. It will never happen. That's not where they are. It's not how they're using Google AdWords. Various media touches people at all different stages in the funnel and impacts their decision. Reaching consumers early is what awareness is about. And if you're the person that talks to them about this awareness, it's a very helpful stage in them actually continuing with you through the purchase process. Other media influences people at the point that they realize, huh, I'm kind of interested in a zero turn radius lawnmower. I got some tight corners in my yard. I never realized such a crazy thing as this. I could just sit there and just turn it and spin in that same spot all day long if I wanted. Make me sick, I don't really like the tilt-a-whirl, but it could be a fun thing to do. I'm actually considering buying that thing. I think it would be really neat. And various media is touching them, sharing that message with them. Friends are talking about it. Someone got a picture of them and they posted it on Facebook. God, that looks so cool. She is having such a good time. She's drinking beer. I can't believe it while she's using her ZTR lawnmower. That's crazy. I think I want to purchase. Okay, this is a different phase. This could take 3 weeks. It could take 3 days. It could take 3 years. We don't know where they are in this marketing bridge when we're talking to them in our messaging. Some people are at some point in time, all of your customers are in some phase, and all of your customers, and a customer is always in some phase. So you want to be mindful that you can be talking about these different kinds of messages. It is helpful in deploying different media to do so. They want to purchase. Now, most of the time, they're not going to a radio station to sit and listen and hope. Are you going to advertise zero-turn radiuses lawnmowers soon today? I started listening at 6 a.m. How come you haven't done anything about it? It's not where they're going. They're going to a medium like print. They're probably going online doing some searching. They're looking at businesses online that they know have those kinds of things. I'm going to go visit the store. I'm very curious now. I want to go sit in this seat and see if it's as comfortable as they say it is, and it's got a cup holder. I love that thing. I'm going to go to their website and learn a little bit more about them, get some more information from them. This is where Google AdWords comes into play. That's why people say this is my best source of reference and referral. No, it's not. It's the yellow pages of the electronic world. It is not ever touching people up the funnel. And it's important to remember, it's vital you have Google AdWords. Back in the day, it was important that you had a yellow pages ad. If that was your entire marketing budget, there is something very wrong with your funnel, because you will never bring in new people. It's only people that you help. Once someone else has been sending all those messages, they'll fall in your lap instead. You have to influence them before that. And then they come make the purchase, your point of sale, your price and item, whatever it is that also drove them to that. But all these stages in the marketing bridge matter to you in how you communicate with them about what might motivate them. So you can consider your cycles in this equation as well. There's seasonality, there are trends, your competition, what add-ons do you have for this that make it compelling and interesting. It could be lots of other things. Here's a great example of taking these components and putting them together in an 8th page ad, because some of us say, that's great, but I can't do that in a 60-second commercial. So here's a very well done, it's an 8th page ad. It looks a lot larger here because School Life isn't quite that big, but it's an 8th page ad that ran in School Life Troy in June, and July, I beg your pardon, it was in the July issue. So successful placement. It was July issue, unleash your inner musician. Well, if I'm 12, 13, I can actually relate to that. I want to unleash my inner musician. I get that. So that copy is speaking to this 12 or 13-year-old who's also the visual in the picture. Free lessons to new clients in July. Okay, that's kind of cool. I've got the seasonality right. I'm talking to the right audience. And they are looking at school life at this particular age group. And my continuity is these ads tend to look the same from issue to issue in that there's a continuity in the theme. And at-home music lessons, their logo is very cool. It's very crystal clear. It's got a great component in it. Honestly, that's probably enough for them to have continuity using that logo in a well-placed situation. Guitar, piano, drums, violin, come on down. You know, if you're Beethoven, it doesn't make any difference. If you're Bach, come on. We're going to play along. And so this headline, the graphic, the logo, the look, made this a very well-done feeling ad because I still want to be in the storytelling arena, and the headline did. And it can be that small. So we talk about customer patterns, message consistency, storytelling, targeting, messaging. I need to move faster. We're going to move to choosing media platforms. This is just a snapshot of Times Square. We've all heard this great thing that studies show that we're exposed to 3,000 to 20,000 messages or impressions a day, yet we can only process a few hundred at best. None of that really matters because they're even talking about, you know, what's on the label of my shirt. Most of these messages are not intended for you and me. I only need to be relevant in that place where I know my customers are. And there are so many choices, as we well know. You can be in any kind of environment and in any kind of media platform, but we still want to be relevant to them in that platform. We'll talk about that as we go. In media platforms, there's traditional, typically we know, print, radio, television. Those are kind of direct mail. Those are what we refer to as non-traditional. And there's, of course, this huge category of non-traditional, the explosion of digital media. And digital marketing is basically just the application of that, no matter what format it's in. And this has been an exponential time of growth. But these things are only tools that you have at your disposal, and the same rules apply. So tips for choosing media. What ones do I go to? How do I figure out what it is that serves me best as a media platform? This is how you think of it. It doesn't matter how much money you have. It doesn't matter how many media platforms are out there. It doesn't matter what industry you're in. You use the same criteria to filter them. You have to determine for any platform, understanding the platform, what is the platform in its usage? Where is it? Who is the platform delivering? Who is their audience? And how do they relate to them? Does this audience look like your audience? So this question hasn't got anything to do with your industry or what you're in or the size of your business. Does their audience look like my primary audience? Now, is it their primary audience? So you need to understand enough about that platform before you determine how much to invest there. How does it fit into your media mix? I've got various things in my media mix. Where does it fit in the equation? Because I have to touch people in all these different phases of the marketing funnel, and no one medium ever is the silver bullet today. We know that. You have to use a myriad of media. And what is the pricing and packaging? Is it something that I can equate to that's feasible for me within my budget? What are the things that they can do that might bring value added to me to make it sing even louder? Is it bundling print with the online component? What are those things that come with it? And how do I measure that? What am I really doing? What is it that I'm looking for? What is the significant difference? Even if it's the return of faces I haven't seen in a while, or more traffic on this given day. It can be a little bit more evasive than you think. It isn't necessarily the immediate at the cash register sale. So we've kind of whipped through choosing media platforms. But again, it's the same idea, no matter how big, no matter how small, I'm doing Father and Son again. You have to use the same criteria and filters to choose media platforms. And we're going to talk about that specifically. Who's using it? How does the audience use the platform? Why is it used? Why are they using it? What are they doing with it? When do they tend to use it? Where are they using it? Are they driving their car when they're using it? We call that a billboard. Speak in relevant fashion to them in that medium with all of these variables in mind. So here's an example. I was guilty as charged driving up here this morning, listening to WDBD. And for those of you who have at some point in time in your lives touched on 96.3 WDBD, they've been a leader in the market for a long time with adults 25-54. They're a good, strong station. It's hot AC, they call it. It's kind of a fun format. They just last week blew out one of their morning show talent, Allison, and it was Blaine and Allison in the morning. So now it's just the Blaine Fowler show and sidekicks. And they're going to struggle in that arena, having made that change. But the point of understanding WDVD is like any media platform out there, all of them work This is important news for you to remember. All of those media platforms work. They may not work for you. And they may work for you if used properly. So for example, this happens all the time. If someone likes someone, or a friend of theirs is selling that, or it's a really cool package and I got Red Wing suite tickets, doesn't make it a good buy for your marketing messages. You have to understand the medium and how it's being deployed and how they're interacting with people that you need to speak with. If you ran on WDVD, it would be vital that you were trying to speak to women 25-54, not adults 25-54. Segregate that. Go for their sweet spot, women 25-54. To be exact, they actually slide up the age spectrum a little bit. They're more like 35-54. Blaine would say we're 35-45, but no, he's not. They're now into the 54 category because they've been in that format for 20 years and they've aged. Listeners aged with them. So that's what's happened here. So if you're looking for women 35-54 and you've got a message that can go across the market, not just specific to this geography, WDVD could be a great purchase for you. If you're trying to reach men, you'll probably get a couple here. For sure, men do listen to WDVD. There's nothing wrong with that. People younger, people older. Their primary target audience needs to look like yours, or it's not a good choice. It doesn't matter how good the deal is, don't take it. Always look at the medium. What are they doing? How does it relate to the audience you need that looks like your audience? How are they using it? Well, they listen to it. It's a passive medium. I'm having such a great time. I love Sam Smith. Yeah. That's not a medium that I'm looking for information. Radio in general is a passive medium. It's an entertainment medium. There are exceptions to the rule. News and weather together on the 8th. Traffic and weather together on the 8th. Yes, we know that. I'm going there. On the 8th, got to click in. Got it. Yep, there's an accident right in front of me. I thought so. I can see it. Thank you. Back to Blaine and Allison. So it is indeed an active medium in a certain place. But primarily, radio is a passive medium. It's an entertainment medium. So you want to be careful when you're in that environment what your messaging is going to look like. Obviously, timing. Biggest day part in everybody is morning drive or afternoon drive. All the other day parts are actually very effective and very price point effective if used properly. But they now switch gears. In the mornings, you tend to be in your car listening to them. In midday, you might be listening when you're in the office. In afternoon drive, you're coming home. And in the evening, it could be now in the dining room or it could be outside. So just remember, people are in different cycles when they're listening as well and where they are. So that could be relevant to your message. And if you're going to speak to them, the language you want to speak in is going to be appealing to a female lifestyle. So all of these variables could make this radio station right for you if this looks like your audience. Here's a print example, something that we can apply that's very specific and near and dear to our hearts because you're here today, and thank you for coming on behalf of School Life. I don't think I said that at the front. Thank you for coming. And we are glad you're here. So a print example is School Life. Who are they speaking to? School Life, swimming upstream from print media, swimming upstream from print media, reaches a young demographic. It speaks to youth. If you put an ad in here that you ran in the Detroit News, you have just spent money you should not have spent. Detroit News is 50 plus males. That's who is primarily reading the Detroit News. It does not mean 32-year-old women or not. It means the primary demographic is 50 plus males. There is nothing wrong with that medium. It is a very important medium. It's a viable medium. It's a great place to deliver the 50-plus male audience. If you're trying to speak to youth and you talk to them in the same language you would talk to a 50-year-old man, okay, if you think that's going to work, I beg to differ. You want to speak to them in the environment, in the age demographic, and for the most part, when you're talking to youth in a vehicle like this, you're talking to tweens and teens from 12 to 17. They're the ones looking for, our school got in, that's me in the marching band, I can't believe they wrote that article about my best friend. This is a medium that speaks to youth in print. It is an unusual animal. Print, in most cases, people say, it's eroding, it's dying on the vine. Well, print is an entire category, isn't dying on a vine. I've never seen more niche publications in my entire life. Print media is slivering itself very effectively and doing lots of different ways about that. As long as you understand who their audience is and to use it, that dying audience is still 500,000 people on Sunday. I bet it's bigger than the people who come through your door every day. So how do you speak to it properly? In this instance, since print medium, is the Troy School District robust? Are there plenty of youth in this school system? Is it energetic and vibrant? I can tell from this boardroom it is. It's a good place to talk to people that are between the ages of 12 and 17. That is the primary target audience in school life. Secondary is mom and dad. But what happens if I'm 13 years old and I'm looking at this publication? Who's looking over my shoulder? You get mom and dad by default. Don't target for them. Target the youth. If you are targeting mom and dad, please be cognizant that's the secondary audience. There can be reasons why State Farm Insurance wants to talk to the secondary audience. But be cognizant of the fact that that's who it is that you're talking to. Primary audience, they love their Zoyo yogurt. When you talk to them in school life, it's a monthly publication, but of course you have the ability to do that online with their web component, with Facebook messaging. There's all kinds of things that you can package together. You speak with Michelle Torres about that, marketing expert for school life. She's sitting in the back of the room and invited all of you here today. So they're reading it primarily when they first get it at school. Got it with me. I got it at school. That's the first place they're reading, and they're looking at it with their pals. They do have to take it home, so it was probably being looked at home. They want to show mom what it was that they thought was so interesting. Dad, too. I didn't mean to eliminate dad. I'm just talking, just using a hypothetical theory. And there could be other places looking at it. They could be looking at it in the car, really sick and tired when mom asked me how school was today. La, 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 I wish I could text. She took my phone away. Okay. So they might be looking at it in various opportunities as well. But the important thing to remember is this platform is youth-focused. Youth-focused. Speak to youth when you message here, please. So how does this ad fit? It's a print ad. It makes sense in the free press. Kind of. It does. Is anybody here from Pools and Spas? I'd love to see these folks because I love pools more than anything in the world, and I'm really fond of spas. But this primary message really talks to men, and it probably belongs in the free press or the news. What's wrong with this picture in school life? If I'm a woman, first of all, I don't look like that in my bikini. I got news for you. I wish I did. I actually can't look at that ad. It actually makes me feel disenfranchised from you. Oh boy, the graphic disenfranchised me. And I am most certainly not going to let my 12-year-old son look at that. This ad did not work in school life the way it could have. And that's what to remember. Where would it go and where would it fit? This is not the right messaging. You want to see kids playing in the pool, having a ball, ask mom for the pool so you're the neighbor, you're the house everyone comes to in the neighborhood. Doesn't that speak to a kid? So easy, just turn the messaging. So easy. How does this ad fit? In school life, a new opportunity awaits you after graduation. It's talking right to me. I love this. It's a great print ad. It's a quick message. It's part of my life. It's the fabric of my life. It's the graduation issue of school life, and you're talking to me. It's relevant, and that's the important thing about content messaging. Make sense? I see yeses. Have I put anybody to sleep yet? Oh, good. All right. I see a couple of no's. Someone nodded off. Michelle, that's you. So, cool. Thank you for paying attention and helping me share this message for you about customer patterns, message consistency, storytelling, targeting messages, choosing media platforms, apply the right message, and the inner dynamics of how come content matters for you. But when you are talking to folks about media, grill them about who their media vehicle speaks with, how they relate to it, what is it about it that people do, where it sings, and that's where you want to be. There's no media platform out there that doesn't work. It works somehow, somewhere for someone. Or it wouldn't exist. It does work. It might just not be the right one for you. I love it when advertisers say to me, I've done newspaper, radio, television, social media, none of it works. The only thing I can ask is, what are you doing wrong? Let me look at what you've done. And a component, it's only ever one tiny thing. It's never huge, because you know most of what it is that you're doing. And you do most of it right. You just want it sharper.
Yeah, I think it was really informative. Again, it's just because you can, especially as a business owner, you can get stuck in the operations of the business, and you think you're always trying to talk to the same people, and that's not necessary in the same way, and it's very easy to get into a rut. And so this kind of thing, kind of helps jolt you out, of that rut.
Totally energized. Sandy's fabulous. It re-sparked things in my mind for advertising that I wasn't thinking about. So that alone help me. I want to go back to the office now, get some things done. I took notes, and I'm going to turn what she did verbally into new ads. Matter of fact, I found your demographic is a little different than I thought, and I'm going to reposition those ads to that market, which that's what the best takeaway from this was to position myself well to my market.
Throughout the conversation that we had, and I say conversation even though it wasn't two-way, but the way her presentation style was, it felt like a conversation. I loved all of her stories, but I kept notes and took notes throughout the entire time. Even though I've been doing my particular business for 11 years, I learned so much, and I'm very glad that I was invited to come.